This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. Spiro Theodore Agnew, ˈspɪroʊ Agnew, November 9, 1918. George McGovern from South Dakota and Ambassador Sergeant Shriver from Maryland in 1973, Agnew was investigated by the United States Attorney for the District of Maryland on charges of extortion, tax fraud, bribery, and conspiracy. He was charged with having accepted bribes totaling more than $100,000 while holding office as Baltimore County Executive, Governor of Maryland, and Vice President on October 10 that same year. Agnew was allowed to plead no contest to a single charge that he had failed to report $29,500 of income received in 1967, with the condition that he resign the office of Vice President Nixon. Later replaced Agnew by appointing House Minority Leader Gerald Ford as Vice President the following year. When Nixon resigned from the White House due to the Watergate scandal, Ford ascended to the presidency. Agnew was the second Vice President in United States history to resign, the other being John C. Calhoun, and the only one to do so because of criminal charges. Nearly 10 years after leaving office, Agnew paid the state of Maryland nearly $270,000 as a result of a civil suit that stemmed from the bribery allegations. In describing Agnew, Gary Wills borrows the backhanded compliment once paid Coolidge by H. L. Mencken: "No man ever came to market with less seductive goods, and no man ever got a better price for what he had to offer." Agnew is widely considered by historians to be among the worst vice presidents in the history of the United States. Contents: 1. Early life. 2. Early political career. 3. Governor of Maryland 1967-1969. 4. Vice Presidency 1969-1973. 4. 1. Resignation. 5. Later life and death. 6. Tributes. 7. Electoral history. 8. References. 9. External links. Early life. Coat of arms of Spiro Agnew. Spiro Agnew was born in Baltimore, Maryland. His parents were Theodore Spiros Agnew, a Greek immigrant who shortened his name from Anagnostopoulos. Anagnostopoulos, originally from Gargallionoi, Messenia, when he moved to the United States, and Margaret Marion Akers Pollard Agnew, a native of Virginia. Spiro had a half-brother, Roy Pollard. From his mother's first marriage, she was widowed at the time she met Spiro's father. Agnew eschewed his father's Greek Orthodox Church. His Greek family has direct lineage from the island of Chios. Agnew attended Forest Park Senior High School in Baltimore, before enrolling at Johns Hopkins University in 1937. He studied chemistry at Hopkins for 3 years. Agnew was drafted into the United States Army in 1941 and was commissioned on May 25, 1942. Upon graduation from Army Officer Candidate School, he served with the 10th Armored Division in Europe during World War II. He was awarded the Bronze Star for his service in France and Germany before leaving for Europe. Agnew worked at the Maryland Casualty Company, where he met Eleanor Judefind, known as Judy. Agnew married her on May 27, 1942. They had 4 children, Pamela, James Rand, Susan, and Kimberly. Upon his return from the war, Agnew transferred to the evening program at the University of Baltimore School of Law. He studied law at night while working as a grocer and as an insurance salesman during the day. In 1947, Agnew received his LLB, later amended to Juris Doctor, and moved to the suburbs to begin practicing law. He passed the Maryland bar exam in June 1949. Agnew was recalled to service with the Army in 1950 during the Korean War. Early political career. Spiro Agnew began his political career as the first president of the Lock Raven Community Council and the president of the Dumbarton Junior High School PTA. A Democrat from early youth, he switched parties and became a Republican during the 1950s. He aided U.S. Congressman James Devereux in winning 4 successive elections in 1957. He was appointed to the Baltimore County Board of Zoning Appeals by Democratic Baltimore County Executive Michael J. Birmingham in 1960. He made his first run for office as a candidate for Judge of the Circuit Court, finishing last in a 5-person contest the following year. The new Democratic Baltimore County Executive, Christian H. Call, dropped him from the Zoning Board. Agnew ran for election as Baltimore County Executive in 1962, seeking office in a predominantly Democratic county that had seen no Republican elected to that position in the 20th century, with only one Roger B. Hayden earning victory after he left running as a reformer and Republican outsider. He took advantage of a bitter split in the Democratic Party and was elected. Agnew backed and signed an ordinance outlawing discrimination in some public accommodations, among the first laws of this kind in the United States. Governor of Maryland Maryland 1967-1969. Agnew ran for the position of Governor of Maryland in 1966 in this overwhelmingly Democratic state. He was elected after the Democratic nominee, George P. Mahoney, a Baltimore paving contractor and perennial candidate running on an anti-integration platform, narrowly won the Democratic gubernatorial primary out of a crowded slate of eight candidates, trumping early favorite Carlton R. Sickles coming on the heels of the recently passed Federal Fair Housing Act. Of 1965, Mahoney's campaign embraced the slogan, "Your home is your castle, protect it." Many Democrats opposed to segregation then crossed party lines to give Agnew the governorship by 82,000 votes as governor. Agnew worked with the Democratic legislature to pass tax and judicial reforms, as well as tough anti-pollution laws projecting an image of racial moderation. Agnew signed the state's first open housing laws and succeeded in effecting the repeal of an anti-miscegenation law. However, during the riots that followed the assassination of Martin Luther King Jr., in the spring of 1968, Agnew angered many African-American leaders when he stated in reference to their constituents, "I call on you to publicly repudiate all black racists. This, so far, you have been unwilling to do." Vice Presidency 1969-1973. Spiro Agnew is sworn in as Vice President in 1969. Front row, from left to right, Lyndon B. Johnson, Richard Nixon, Everett Dirksen, Spiro Agnew with hand raised, Hubert Humphrey. Agnew's moderate image, immigrant background, and success in a traditionally Democratic state made him an attractive running mate for the 1968 Republican presidential nominee, former Vice President Richard Nixon. As late as early 1968, Agnew was a strong supporter of Nelson Rockefeller, one of Nixon's opponents, but by June had switched to supporting Nixon at the 1968 Republican National Convention. Agnew's nomination was supported by many conservatives. Within the Republican Party and by Nixon himself, however, a small band of delegates started shouting "Spiro who?" and tried to nominate George W. Romney. In the end, Nixon's wishes prevailed, with Agnew receiving 1,119 out of the 1,317 votes cast during the ensuing general election campaign against Vice President Hubert Humphrey, which took place against a backdrop of urban riots and anti-Vietnam War demonstrations, culminating in the violent confrontations at the Democratic Convention in Chicago. Agnew repeatedly hammered the Democrats on the issue of law and order. Agnew was considered something of a political joke at first. One Democratic television commercial featured the sounds of a man's hearty laughter as the camera panned to a TV with the words "Agnew for Vice President" on the screen. Agnew went from his first election as county executive to vice president in 6 years, one of the fastest rises in U.S. political history, comparable with that of Nixon, who became vice president after 4 years in the House of Representatives and 2 years in the Senate. Agnew's vice presidency was also the highest-ranking U.S. political office ever reached by either a Greek-American or a Marylander. Vice President Spiro Agnew, wearing gray blazer and sunglasses, and former President Lyndon B. Johnson view the liftoff of Apollo 11 from Pad 39A at Kennedy Space Center. Agnew soon found his role as the voice of the so-called silent majority, and by late 1969, he was ranking high on national most admired men polls. He also inspired a fashion craze when one entrepreneur introduced Spiro Agnew watches, a takeoff on the popular Mickey Mouse watch. Conservatives wore them to show their support for Agnew, while many liberals wore them to signify their contempt. Agnew was known for his scathing criticisms of political opponents, especially journalists and anti-war activists. Agnew would attack his adversaries with relish, hurling unusual, often alliterative epithets, some of which were coined by White House speechwriters William Safire and Pat Buchanan, including "pusillanimous pussyfooters," "nattering nabobs of negativism," written by Safire, and "hopeless, hysterical hypochondriacs of history." In a speech denouncing the moratorium to end the war in Vietnam, he characterized the war's opponents as "an effete corps of impudent snobs who characterize themselves as intellectuals." Agnew was often characterized as Nixon's "hatchet man" when defending the administration on the Vietnam War. Agnew was chosen to make several speeches in which he spoke out against anti-war protesters and the media portrayal of the Vietnam War, labeling them "un-American." However, he also spoke publicly against the actions of the Ohio Army National Guard that led to the Kent State shootings in 1970, even describing their action as murder. Despite Agnew's continued loyalty to the Nixon administration, his relationship with Nixon deteriorated almost from the start of their political affiliation, although Nixon initially liked and respected Agnew. As time progressed, he felt his vice president lacked the intelligence and vision, particularly in foreign affairs, to sit in the Oval Office, and he began freezing Agnew out of the White House decision-making process by some accounts. The president was also resentful that the self-confident Agnew was so popular with many Americans by 1970. Agnew was limited to seeing the president only during cabinet meetings or in the occasional and brief one-on-one, with Agnew given no opportunity to discuss much of substance. Oval Office tapes reveal that in 1971, Nixon and his chief of staff, H.R. Haldeman, discussed their desire to have Agnew resign from office before the following year's campaign season. One plan to achieve this was to try to persuade conservative investors to purchase one of the television networks, and then invite Agnew to run it. Another was to see if Bob Hope would be willing to take Agnew on as his partner in his cable television investments. These and other plans never went beyond the talking stages. Nixon would have liked to replace Agnew on the Republican ticket in 1972 with John Connally, his chosen successor for 1976, but he realized that Agnew's large conservative base of supporters would be in an uproar, so he reluctantly kept him as his running mate. When John Ehrlichman, the president's counsel and assistant, asked Nixon why he kept Agnew on the ticket in the 1972 election, Nixon is said to have described Agnew as his best insurance against assassination, given that no assassin in his right mind would kill me. They know if they did that they would wind up with Agnew. Agnew came to enjoy the privileges that being vice president brought to him, particularly access to the rich and famous. He became close friends with Frank Sinatra, Billy Graham, and Bob Hope, and consorted with leaders around the globe. He took in stride his newfound fame, as his utterances often made newspaper front pages and were major stories on the evening network news broadcasts. Invitations for Agnew to give speeches across the country flooded into his office, and he became a top fundraiser for the Republican Party. Spiro Agnew congratulates Launch Control after the launch of Apollo 17 in 1972. In April 1973, when revelations about Watergate began to surface, Agnew was the choice of 35% of Republican voters to be the next Republican nominee for president, while then California Governor Ronald Reagan was second on the Gallup poll. Resignation on October 10, 1973, Spiro Agnew became the second vice president to resign the office, unlike John C. Calhoun, who resigned to take a seat in the Senate. Agnew resigned and then pleaded no contest to criminal charges of tax evasion, part of a negotiated resolution to a scheme wherein he was accused of accepting more than $100,000 in bribes during his tenure as governor of Maryland. Agnew was fined $10,000 and received 3 years probation. The $10,000 fine covered only the taxes and interest due on what was unreported income from 1967. The plea bargain was later mocked by former Maryland Attorney General Stephen H. Sachs as the greatest deal since the Lord spared Isaac on the mountaintop. Students of Professor John F. Banshaf III from the George Washington University Law School, collectively known as Banshaf's Bandits, found four residents of the state of Maryland willing to put their names on a case that sought to have Agnew repay the state $268,482, the amount it was said he had taken in bribes after two appeals by Agnew. He finally wrote a check for $268,482 that was turned over to Maryland State Treasurer William S. James in 1983 as a result of his no-contest plea. The Maryland judiciary later disbarred Agnew, calling him morally obtuse. As in most jurisdictions, Maryland lawyers are automatically disbarred after being convicted of a felony, and a no-contest plea exposes the defendant to the same penalties as one would face with a guilty plea. Agnew's resignation triggered the first use of the 25th Amendment, specifically Section 2, as the vacancy prompted the appointment and confirmation of Gerald Ford, the House Minority Leader, as his successor. This remains one of only two instances in which the amendment has been employed to fill a vice presidential vacancy. The second time was when Ford, after becoming president upon Nixon's resignation, chose Nelson Rockefeller, originally Agnew's mentor in the moderate wing of the Republican Party, to succeed him as vice president had Agnew remained as vice president. When Nixon resigned just 10 months later, Agnew himself would have become the 38th president. Instead of Ford. Later life and death. After leaving politics, Agnew became an international trade executive with homes in Rancho Mirage, California, Arnold, Maryland, Bowie, Maryland, and near Ocean City, Maryland in 1976. He briefly re-entered the public spotlight and engendered controversy with what Gerald Ford publicly criticized as unsavory remarks about Jews and anti-Zionist statements that called for the United States to withdraw its support for the State of Israel, citing Israel's allegedly bad treatment of Christians in 1980. Agnew published a memoir in which he implied that Nixon and his chief of staff, Alexander Haig, had planned to assassinate him if he refused to resign the vice presidency, and that Haig told him to go quietly or else. The memoir's title. Agnew also wrote a novel, The Canfield Decision, about a vice president who was destroyed by his own ambition. Agnew always maintained that the tax evasion and bribery charges were an attempt by Nixon to divert attention from the growing Watergate scandal after his resignation. Nixon never spoke to him again as a gesture of reconciliation. Nixon's daughters invited Agnew to attend Nixon's funeral in 1994, and Agnew accepted in 1996. When Agnew died, Nixon's daughters returned the favor by attending Agnew's funeral. Agnew died on September 17, 1996, at age 77 at Atlantic General Hospital, in Berlin, Maryland, in Worcester County near his Ocean City home, after struggling with undiagnosed acute leukemia. Agnew is buried at Dulany Valley Memorial Gardens, a cemetery in Timonium, Maryland, in Baltimore County in the Garden of the Last Supper section of the cemetery. Tributes. Agnew's official portrait was taken down from the Maryland State House Governor's Reception Room from 1979 until 1995. Governor Paris Glendening stated that in re-including Agnew's portrait, it was not up to anyone to alter history, whether for good or bad. He cited the 1949 novel 1984 under the provisions of an 1886 Senate resolution. All former vice presidents are entitled to a portrait bust in the United States Capitol. Plans were set in motion for a bust of Agnew while he was still in office, but were shelved following his resignation. The idea was revived by the Senate Rules Committee in 1992, and a bust was commissioned from North Carolina artist William Behrens, for whom Agnew sat for four sessions. The bust was unveiled May 24, 1995. In the presence of Agnew, his family, friends, and one-time political supporters, Agnew made a short speech and was visibly moved by the occasion. Electoral history. Baltimore County Executive, 1962. Spiro Agnew R., elected unopposed Governor of Maryland, 1966. Spiro Agnew R., 455,318 4,950%. George P. Mahoney D., 373,543 4,061%. Hyman A. Pressman I., 90,899 988%. 1968 Republican National Convention Vice Presidential Tally. Spiro Agnew, 1,119 8,395%. George Romney, 186 1,395%. Abstaining, 16,120%. John Lindsay, 10,075%. Edward Brooke, 1,008%. James A. Rhodes, 1,008%. United States Presidential Election, 1968. Richard Nixon. Spiro Agnew R., 31,783,783 434% and 301 electoral votes. 32 states carried. Hubert Humphrey, Edmund Muskie D., 31,271,839 427% and 191 electoral votes. 13 states and D.C. carried. George Wallace, Curtis LeMay. American Independent, 9,901,118 135% and 46 electoral votes. 5 states carried. 1972 Republican National Convention Vice Presidential Tally. Spiro Agnew Inc., 1,345 9,978% abstaining, 2,015% David Brinkley, 1,007% United States Presidential Election, 1972 Richard Nixon. Spiro Agnew R. Inc., 47,168,710 607% and 520 electoral votes. 49 states carried. George McGovern, Sergeant Shriver D., 29,173,222 375% and 17 electoral votes. 1 state and D.C. carried. John Hospers, Theodora Natalia. Nathan Libertarian, 3,171,000% and 1 electoral vote. Republican Faithless Elector John G. Schmitz. Thomas J. Anderson A.I., 1,100,868 14% and 0 electoral votes. Linda Jenis, Andrew Pulley. Socialist Workers, 83,380 0.1% Benjamin Spock. Julius Hobson. Peoples, 78,759 0.1% References. Carrot. The Religion of Spiro T. Agnew, U.S. Vice President. AdherenceCom. Retrieved October 10, 2011. Carrot. Noonan, Peggy. November 24, 2007. People Before Profits. OpinionJournal.com. Retrieved October 10, 2011. stocked with wines. The New York Times. Carrot Critchlow, Donald T. 2007 The Conservative Ascendancy, How the GOP Right Made Political History Cambridge, Massachusetts, Harvard University Press p. Carrot Kleins, Francis 10 September 19, 1996 Spiro T. Agnew, Point Man for Nixon Who Resigned Vice Presidency, Dies at 77. The New York Times retrieved November 28, 2007. Carrot Agnew asserts he is not a bigot, defends right to criticize Israel. The New York Times July 31, 1976 retrieved November 28, 2007. January 2016. States Congress. Proceeded. 1966 succeeded. Daniel D. Tompkins, John C. Calhoun, Martin Van Buren, Richard Mentor Johnson, John Tyler, George M. Dallas, Millard Fillmore, William R. King, John C. Breckinridge, Hannibal Hamlin, Andrew Johnson, Schuyler Colfax, Henry Wilson, William A. Wheeler, Chester A. Arthur, Thomas A. Hendricks, Levi P. Morton, Adlai Stevenson, I. Garrett Hobart, Theodore Roosevelt, Charles W. Fairbanks, James S. Sherman, Thomas R. Marshall, Calvin Coolidge, Charles G. Dawes, Charles Curtis, John Nance Garner, Henry A. Wallace, Harry S. Truman, Alvin W. Barkley, Richard Nixon, Lyndon B. Johnson, Hubert Humphrey, Spiro Agnew, Gerald Ford, Nelson Rockefeller. Walter Mondale, George H. W. Bush, Dan Quayle, Al Gore, Dick Cheney, Joe Biden, Mike Pence, elect VE United States Republican Party chairpersons of the RNC, Morgan Raymond, Ward Claflin, Morgan Chandler. Cameron Jewell, Sabin Jones, Key Clarkson, Carter, Hannah Payne, Cortelyou, New Hitchcock, Hill, Rosewater Hills, Wilcox, Hayes, Adams. Butler Work Houston Fess Sanders Fletcher Hamilton Martin Walsh Spangler Brownell Reese Scott Gabrielson Summerfield Roberts Hall Alcorn. T. B. Morton Miller Birch Bliss R. Morton Dole Bush Smith Brock Richards Laxalt Fahrenkopf Reagan, Fahrenkopf Atwater Uter Bond Barber Nicholson Gilmore. Racicot Gillespie Melman Martinez Duncan Steele Priebus Presidential tickets Fremont, Dayton Lincoln, Hamlin Lincoln, Johnson Grant, Colfax Grant, Wilson Hayes, Wheeler Garfield, Arthur Blaine, Logan Harrison, Morton Harrison, Reed. McKinley, Hobart McKinley, Roosevelt Roosevelt, Fairbanks Taft, Sherman Taft, Sherman, Butler Hughes, Fairbanks Harding, Coolidge Coolidge, Dawes Hoover, Curtis twice Landon, Knox Wilkie, McNary Dewey, Bricker Dewey, Warren Eisenhower, Nixon twice Nixon, Lodge Goldwater, Miller Nixon, Agnew twice Ford, Dole. Reagan, G. H. W. Bush twice G. H. W. Bush, Quayle twice Dole, Kemp G. W. Bush, Cheney twice McCain, Palin Romney, Ryan Trump, Pence parties by state and territory state Alabama Alaska Arizona Arkansas California Colorado Connecticut Delaware Florida, Georgia, Hawaii, Idaho, Illinois, Indiana, Iowa, Kansas, Kentucky, Louisiana, Maine, Maryland, Massachusetts, Michigan, Minnesota, Mississippi, Missouri, Montana Nebraska, Nevada, New Hampshire, New Jersey, New Mexico, New York, North Carolina, North Dakota, Ohio, Oklahoma, Oregon, Pennsylvania, Rhode Island, South Carolina, South Dakota, Tennessee, Texas, Utah. Vermont, Virginia, Washington, West Virginia, Wisconsin, Wyoming, Territory, American Samoa, District of Columbia, Guam, Northern Mariana Islands, Puerto Rico, Virgin Islands, Conventions List 1856, Philadelphia, 1860, Chicago, 1864, Baltimore. 1868 Chicago 1872 Philadelphia 1876 Cincinnati 1880 Chicago 1884 Chicago 1888 Chicago 1892 Minneapolis 1896 St. Louis 1900 Philadelphia 1904 Chicago 1908 Chicago 1912 Chicago 1916 Chicago 1920 Chicago 1924 Cleveland 1928 Kansas City 1932 Chicago 1936 Cleveland 1940 Philadelphia 1944 Chicago 1948 Philadelphia 1952 Chicago 1956 San Francisco 1960 Chicago 1964 San Francisco 1968 Miami Beach 1972 Miami Beach 1976 Kansas City 1980 Detroit 1984 Dallas 1988 New Orleans 1992 Houston 1996 San Diego 2000 Philadelphia 2004 New York 2008 St. Paul. 2012 Tampa, 2016 Cleveland affiliated organizations fundraising groups National Republican Congressional Committee, National Republican Senatorial Committee, Republican Conference of the United States House of Representatives, Republican Conference of the United States Senate, Republican Governors Association Sectional Groups, College Republicans Chairman, Congressional Hispanic Conference, International Democrat Union, Log Cabin Republicans, Republican Jewish Coalition, Republican National Hispanic Assembly.